A very good afternoon to all, and thank you for joining us for today's e-personality development workshop on legal profession and public speaking skill. I, Dr. Ashu Dhiman, take this opportunity to welcome you all on the behalf of Geetharthan International Business School on this virtual platform for interaction with Advocate Sri Amar Vivek. Geetharthan International Business School was established in year 2004. GIBS is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. Center for Legal Studies, GIBS, conducts law courses for BBA, LLB and BLLB approved by Bar Council of India and management courses by All India Council for Technical Education, Ministry of HRD and Government of India. The institute is accredited as Category A by National Assessment and Accreditation Council and assessed as Category A Plus by State Fee Regulatory Committee and rated highest grading A by Joint Inspection Committee of Government of In-City of Delhi and Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University. The institute has been rated grade A by Academic Audit Cell of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University consecutively from past 7 years. GIBS has also been rated number 2 twice consecutively by Times B School Survey 2019 and 2020. The COVID-19 pandemic is creating significant health, social, economic, and legal challenges worldwide, forcing institutes and universities to shut their physical activities. We at Center for Legal Studies, GIBS, understand that navigating the pace of change, dealing with immediate issues can only be developed through taking regular insight of the problem with the opinion of experts. The first skill that gets a lawyer noticed is the ability to use words to explain and persuade. Public speaking is a necessary professional skill for all competent lawyers. Unfortunately, many do not understand that public speaking is different from just talking. Good public speaking is about ability to communicate and connect with your audience. For lawyers, this is even more important. People think that because you're a lawyer, you are automatically a fearless and brilliant public speaker. The lawyers all know this is not always true. This expectation, though, is one reason why it's more important for lawyers to have good speaking skills than it is for any other professionals. As a lawyer, it is critical that you know how to persuade a judge or tribunal or speak to a group of clients, shareholders, or conference participants. The objective of this workshop is to make the students identify and accept the new age challenges regarding public speaking as upcoming legal professionals. In its perpetual pursuit to deliver existential learning and offer global exposure to legal fraternity, CLS GIBS is very delighted to organize this workshop on legal profession and public speaking skills. And to discuss on this topic, we have with us Advocate Sri Amar Vivek. He is a founding partner, AV Sai Legal LLP, Litigation and Dispute Resolution. Sir is a practicing attorney with 30 years of experience at Honorable Supreme Court of India, High Courts, and National Tribunals. He has handled more than 300 cases in Supreme Court and about 7,700 matters in various High Courts and other courts. Presently conducting about 1,500 active cases in High Courts of Delhi, HP, and Punjab and Haryana, and about 50 cases in Honorable Supreme Court in India. Almost in all fields of law, especially in the field of constitutional law, administrative law, IPR and commercial arbitration, civil rent and eviction, land acquisition, mining, town and country planning, electricity regulatory, urban bodies, education and university, service, labor, IR, environmental compliances, commercial arbitration and recovery of money across various forums including NCLAT, IPR and Copyright Appellate Board, CERC, National Consumer Commission, ITAT, NCLT, CCI, DRAT, etc. Sir is former Additional Advocate General Haryana, Standing Counsel Union Territory Chandigarh, Assistant Advocate General Punjab, Founder Trustee, Sri Satya Sai Grameen Jagriti Haryana. He is a part-time lecturer at Punjab University, Manager HR and IR, Alpha Drug India Limited, Chandigarh. Advocate Sri Amar Vivek is the winner of National Youth Award for Social Work in Villages by Prime Minister of India, January 1987. Sir is also a motivational speaker and a counselor. Now, I would request Sir to take the session forward and illuminate us with his expertise. Over to you, Sir.
Good afternoon. I hope I am audible enough. It's very pleasant for me to be with all of you this afternoon. Whenever somebody asks me that what would be the ideal timings of a session which you would like to take, I generally prefer an afternoon when people are feeling a bit drowsy, sleepy, and I feel that maybe something in me can wake them up. Otherwise, I am a failure. So, it's good that I am connecting with you in this forum. Well, an advocate can never be a good speaker. Why I say so is that an advocate always has to be a good listener in the first instance. He has to listen to his clients. He has to listen to his colleagues. Ultimately listen to his opposite counsel. And finally listen to the honorable judges. And then only he gets a right of audience. In the matter of public speaking, especially in relation to legal profession, one has to be very agile, one has to be very fast, quick, modulate one's strategy according to the situation at hand. We prepare the briefs lasting over several days, present the briefs in the court of law, prepare the arguments, go to the court, and the first word which we utter sometimes proves to be a decider. It could be a disaster, it could be a bliss. Or the first word which the honorable judges like to utter, what they utter, that suddenly takes us off the guard, and the preparation which we would have done, it will be completely derailed. Therefore, one of the fundamental principles that we must follow throughout our lives, without exception, is we have to be absolutely thorough with the chronology of the events and the facts. A lawyer will never lose a case if he is strong on facts. A lawyer will be helped by the bench if he is not so strong on the law. But the moment we utter a wrong fact or we are not able to articulate a particular fact, that proves to be our nemesis. Now I want to start with all of you. Unfortunately, I am not able to see. This is one kind of audience through webinar that I am not able to see you. So I am only seeing myself. But let me try to tell you that how things are in life. Now suppose I share with you, please pardon me for some
technical. Take your time, please.
Are you able to see my screen now? Allow. I think I'll have to go back to the.
Sir, on topmost side, the third button, which shows where you can share.
It shows that, but then I'm not able to. it says Firefox cannot allow you your screen. So maybe the system is such, which is probably creating some problem. Anyway, I'll proceed ahead. In the meantime, I'll keep trying so that if during the
okay, sir. Till then, we'll also work out to fix the same, sir.
Yeah. I thought that maybe because what had happened that initially I had planned another system, but when I got a call from you that I have to share my own screens, then I shifted to a different. This is my courtroom actually. Nowadays, because of the COVID, I have created a courtroom in my house. So
okay.
This is actually my courtroom.
Okay, give us just 2-3 minutes. Give us just 2-3 minutes. So we'll try to fix it up, sir. Okay, till then, please.
All right. So what I want to tell you that a lawyer has always to be ready. For this purpose, first thing, as I told you, was thoroughness, complete knowledge of the facts, and best part to learn facts is through chronology. So that the dates are imprinted in your mind. Now, when I say so, I also want to add one thing. The moment we, as a speaker in any public forum or in a court of law, try to use some aid of a paper, that is the place where we tend to lose the focus. Like I was trying to share the screen, so suddenly it lost the focus. Similarly, in any forum, the moment we try to take the help of a paper to aid our memory, we lose the focus. Let me tell you, a paper book worth 500 pages or 1000 pages in a court of law, when we present, the paper book is lying in front of us, but we hardly read out from the paper book. Most of the judges like to hear us because they themselves would have read the paper book, though they would not have read the way we like to read it. Only at some places we need to read a particular passage, we need to read a particular fact, we need to read a particular event for the knowledge of the judges to emphasize, so that later on when they write the judgment, they remember those facts. Otherwise, most of our arguments are oral. So, a beauty of a lawyer is that he argues extempore without the aid of papers. Now, this requires a thorough reading of the proposition. So, I will be building my session with you on 4 R's. First R is reading. Now this reading has to be very comprehensive. We have to understand that how a lawyer can be successful in life. My recommendation to the students of law and young lawyers is that every day we must read, every day we must read one judgment of Supreme Court or a good judgment of a High Court. If we don't read one, we will not be able to keep pace with the time, the developments which are taking place. Other, we will not be able to build ourselves. You see, let's say we have to go to a party. We get ready. We try to wear the best of the costumes. But in a court of law, our ornament and armament is the reading. So the more we have read the file, the better presentation can be there from our side. So this is the first R which I am trying to emphasize. The second R according to me, is writing. Although it starts with the W. You see, a lawyer's expression always improves, not as much with speaking as it is in the case of writing. Ultimately, we have to draft the petitions, we have to prepare the notes. But what is important also for us is that we must write on the issues around us, some environmental issues, some social issues, even political issues for that matter. Because what happens is, for writing something, we need to collect our thoughts. We need to think. We need to plan. And then we need to express. So mere reading is not enough. Suppose I have read a judgment today. It will be advisable that I write a note about that judgment. That this is what I have understood. Or this is what was held in that case. So that will improve my skill. The third R is enrichment. Now, reading our files, reading our judgments, as I said, reading one judgment every day, that's our duty. That's part of our job. But how do I enrich myself? The first thing is that every day I must learn 5 new words I must add to the vocabulary. I don't say that we should use all bombastic big words when we are speaking or when we are writing or when we are expressing. But yes, we must know at least 5 new words every day. So we should have a kind of ledger with us, as I am having in front of me. So what I do is, every day I write down minimum 5 words, even today. Note down their meanings, try to learn them, so that as and when necessary, those words can come to my aid. Second, I must read some good books. I could read Chagla, I could read Sivai, I could read Iyer, Krishna Iyer, or any good books. That will enrich me. Tomorrow when I am arguing or when I am presenting, the thoughts of such people, they'll come to my aid. And the last is articulation. We never argue. If a son argues with a father, or if a student argues with a teacher, or a lawyer argues in front of a judge, the fate of all of them is going to be the same. So a lawyer never argues in front of the judge. He only articulates that this is the point. This is how I stand to interpret it. And this is how it has been interpreted. This is how it should be interpreted. But we never argue. Argue, according to me, is a very negative kind of word. So these 4 R's, they describe the sum total of public speaking vis-a-vis a lawyer. A lawyer will derive the strength from these 4 principles. Of course, there are some other very important things. Often, when I have to argue a very heavy case means a case involving good arguments. Just prior thereto, I go out in the lobby and try to hymn a song, just to relax myself. Or I like to stand in front of a mirror, just do some rehearsal, see what are my expressions, how my words are coming out. Idea is what? Idea is that suppose the honorable judge is making some observation and my eyes give him a sinister reaction. From a distance they will be able to see. The judges are far more intelligent than what we are. Sometimes even the eyes can decide the case, the expressions can decide the case. Therefore, it is very important that I do my rehearsal very thoroughly. During the reading, I come across some maxims, I come across some words. Am I seen? Alright, sorry. So, I must rehearse them before. I should not get struck on those words, on those meanings, on those expressions during the smooth hearing of my case. So all this exercise is important. But the most important of all is being honest, being candid, being truthful in a court of law. Although it is said commonly that it may not go with the personality of a lawyer, but let me tell you, the relief which we are able to get, the success which we are able to taste as lawyers, if we are honest and truthful, it is phenomenal. We cannot play games and think of winning. If I stand in front of a court, try to seek even an adjournment on some kind of a casual ground, sometimes it may be true also, I am struck up in another court and the case is called in other court, and my colleague gets up and says that my senior is held up somewhere. Sometimes even this may not be seen as a good reason for the court to form an opinion about me. It may feel that as if I am trying to avoid the case. So, honesty and truthfulness in our approach, it always pays. In the long run, it is key to our success. So therefore, when I say that public speaking for a lawyer, public speaking for a lawyer is not a prepared speech which I prepare one day and go and deliver the other day. It is like once George Bernard Shaw was asked to speak on a subject for 1 hour, and he says, oh, 1 hour, then I need to prepare for about 8 hours. And some people asked him that, sir suppose you have to speak for 8 hours, then what? He said, then I can start right now. So preparation from the point of view of a lawyer has to be measured. Measured in the sense that each and everything which we utter in front of the court is bound to have, I would use the word reaction or a response. Therefore, we have to be careful. How do we speak? What we speak? How do we present? That's very important. I can share with you some very good events that have taken place in my life. I remember once I was arguing a case in the Supreme Court. I argued for the entire pre-lunch session for about 2 hours. And then the judges said that we will continue to hear you after lunch. All the judges were not agreeing with me. Now I am in habit of putting a mark on my forehead, a tilak on my forehead. So lunchtime, I found some 15 minutes, I prayed silently. I again put the tilak on my forehead and I was ready for the afternoon session. So afternoon session, the moment I started, again judges were not very, you know, agreeable to my proposition. And I had lost in three courts below. All three judgments of the three courts were against me and I was in appeal before the Supreme Court. So as I was making my submission, one of the judges casually asked me, he says, Mr. Vivek, during lunchtime, did you go to a temple? So I said, no, my lord, I just sat silently and prayed for some time. He says, all right, then we have formed our opinion. We will award you a compensation of rupees 1 lakh to your client. That's what we have decided. Rest already if you can't grant. It's almost 12-14 years back. Amount of 1 lakh was also quite substantial, though I was trying for more. And as I was about to open my mouth and say, my lord, could you just increase this amount? One of the judges remarked, he says, that is also because you prayed during the lunchtime. So your prayer is being answered. I said, my lord, I prayed alone. Now I am before lords. Can I pray more? You see, that instant changes the situation for you. So the judges smiled at me. They said, all right, we are two. We double it up. You get 2 lakhs. So what I want to tell you, a lawyer has to be always very confident. The thorough preparation gives him the confidence. So if he is confident, he knows till the end, without annoying the bench, without annoying the other side, he can still carve out a relief for his client. I remember certain very good instances of cross-examination. I was a young lawyer. Even now I am young, don't take me otherwise. When I am with young people, I am younger. So, I had been appointed as amicus in one of the cases where a foreign national, a Kenyan, had been nabbed with the 10 notes of 100 rupees which were found to be fake. So, the facts were that he had gone to a petrol station at around 8:30 in the evening on a winter evening. He presented 100 rupees note to the salesperson, took petrol for 50 rupees, kept on waiting for the balance of 50 rupees. The salesman did not turn up for about 8 to 10 minutes. This man started shouting. Perhaps the salesman, with the touch of the note, could feel that it is counterfeit. After 10 minutes, when the salesman came out, this man caught hold of his collar and shouted that, why are you not returning my balance? They kept on engaging him. After 20 minutes, police came. They searched him. They found 9 more notes. Eventually, they booked him under various provisions of Indian Penal Code. And 10 fake notes were the case property. Now, the man did not have any lawyer. Court appointed me as an amicus to represent him. So, various people came. Like first of them was a salesperson. I asked him, was somebody holding him for about 30 minutes between the time when he handed over the note to you and when the police came? He said, no, he was standing there. Was he shouting at the top of his voice to get his 50 rupees back and all that? One day I was struck up in the High Court and I got a call from one of my junior colleagues that, sir, a government fingerprint expert has come from Shimla. He has presented a thick report on the comparison of notes. And the Honorable Court is saying that since he is a formal witness, there will be no cross-examination. So shall we leave the witness or you need to come. I said, just wait for me 10 minutes, I'll be there. And within 10 minutes, I rushed. And the court looked at me and asked me, Mr. Vivek, I don't think that you require to ask him anything. I said, my lord, only 2-3 questions. So I pretended as if, you know, I had opened my books. And I said, sir, for how long you are in the field of comparison of disputed documents and notes? He said, for about 30 years. I said, sir, what's your qualification? He said, my qualification is this MSc, so and so, diploma in so and so. I said, sir, in how many cases have you stood as a witness to give testimony of similar nature? He said, over 50 cases. And I said, sir, did you prepare this report by yourself or you had a team with you in preparation, comparison of these notes? You had a junior draftsman, senior draftsman, other people. So he said, yes, we got a team of 5 people. I said, sir, how many man hours did you spend on the comparison? 5 hours, 10 hours, 20 hours, 30 hours. He says about 30, 35 hours. I said, sir, did you compare these notes with bare eye, with naked eye, or you used any appliances such as Microsoft lens, ultraviolet lamp, etc.? So he said, no, we used this apparatus, this used this. That's all. So the judge looked at me quizzingly and said, Mr. Vivek, I thought you were a very thorough lawyer, but you have asked all questions which are irrelevant. I said, Your Honor, I don't want to need any defense evidence. My final argument is ready. I can right now argue the case. She says, all right, you argue the case. I said, Your Honor, my client did not know that these notes are counterfeit. Unless you know that these notes are counterfeit, keeping the notes which are counterfeit is not an offense. He is a foreigner. He remained standing at the petrol station for 30 minutes. He kept on asking the balance. Had he known that the note is counterfeit, he would have run away. And just imagine the situation. A government fingerprint expert with 30 years experience, having so-and-so qualification, having stood as a testimony in 50 cases, cannot by himself say that these notes are counterfeit. He used a team. He spent 35 hours without naked eyes. With naked eyes, he could not say. He used appliances and then came the conclusion that the notes are counterfeit. How could a foreigner come to know by mere touch that these notes are counterfeit? And we got the acquittal for our client. So what I want to tell you, that this I did not prepare in any session. I was not anticipating such a witness. But what gives you the edge? What gives you the edge is your thoroughness. The more thorough you are, the better prepared you are. I'll also share one more experience. There was a young boy, almost 18, who used to come and wash my car. So he used to wash several cars in my neighborhood. One fine day, we came to know that he has been arrested. The allegation was that my next door neighbor, she happened to be the daughter of a high court judge. So she threw the key from the first floor, and it was 6 a.m. She had a new car. The man thought that man is sleeping. So he took out the car, went for a round, and went to the market, must have found some friend. Took about 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, when he came back, he saw police standing. Police arrested him and booked him for theft. So after a few days, this gentleman's father, poor villager from some place in Uttar Pradesh, came to me and said, sir, please help me. So I became his lawyer. Now, I was to cross-examine this lady. who had appeared as a witness to support the prosecution. Now, we all know the court situation. The judge is sitting here. There is a big table in front of him. On one side, there is a prosecution side, other side is a defense side. Now, in the lower courts, lawyers have a tendency to come and sit on the table itself because there are hardly any chairs around. Now, this lady had put her big purse on the place where I was to come and sit and to cross-examine her. So, what I did, seeing that purse was creating obstruction, I picked up the purse, went this side and kept it on this side. This lady observed me, she went all the way, brought back the purse and kept it back at the original place. So my cross-examination commenced and I asked her first question. I said, ma'am, just now in the court, was your purse stolen? She said, no, it just went from here and came back here. I said, how was your car stolen? It also went here and came back. How was it stolen? And that one question was enough for me to get acquittal for my client. So, we have to be aware. We have to be alive. We have to all the time observe the things around us. That is why I say, study, analyze, continue to think, discuss amongst others, and then prepare our brief and then argue. So, the success here is not a one-point formula. Even today, after having put in 30 years in the profession, I can't say I am perfect. I say I am a student. The day I am not a student, that day I will fail. So we have to keep learning. Sometimes we learn from our younger colleagues. Sometimes we learn from others, learn from the bench. And of course, every day we are getting new law, new propositions, new decisions. So for a lawyer, public speaking is no doubt his bread and butter. This is what we do. But public speaking comes with a package, and this is what I have discussed with you. I am not sure how long can I continue. Ma'am, can you just guide me? Or
Yes, sir. You can speak up to 4:30.
Oh, 4:30. Oh, then I think I have enough time. So, as I was telling you, that it is most crucial for us that we take the challenge in front of us in a very succinct manner and always being well prepared. Now I turn to another part. Another part of the story is that how do we prepare a brief or how do we read a judgment? Suppose a judgment is 100 pages or a brief is 400 pages. And I am giving you a recipe that you should read one judgment every day. So you may ask me that, sir, we have our books, we have our syllabus, we have our examination, we have to give projects. How do we really study one judgment every day? This is quite a challenging task. See, I know the story of a man who walked into the kingdom of a king, Krishnadeva Rai, who was a very famous king of Vijayanagara Empire. So he had lifted an elephant on his shoulders. So he came to his darbar with an elephant on his shoulders. And he said, King, I have come to throw a challenge. Anyone in your entire kingdom, if he could replicate this and lift this elephant on his shoulders, I give him 500 gold coins. Otherwise, half of the kingdom comes to me. If you accept this challenge, I am throwing it away. The king was taken aback. And he was a good king. He didn't want to run away from the challenges. So he had a very famous minister. He asked him, what should we do? So the minister whispered something in his ears. And the king replied back. He said, we accept your challenge with just one rider. And the rider is, we have in our stable more than 500 elephants. You go and pick up any one of those elephants. Any elephant you pick up, half kingdom is yours. Otherwise, just go away from there. Now the man could not lift anyone, one of those elephants. Now what's the reason? Reason is, when this man was a young boy and this elephant was only a calf, this man was in habit of lifting that elephant, calf, as a young boy. And he had developed this habit. He had developed the habit of lifting him. Consequently, this elephant also got used to him. Obviously, he could not lift that elephant from the stable one fine day, because he was not habitual. Basically, we need to form a habit. Let's start reading a 10-page judgment, a 15-page judgment. You see, for anything which we require to do, we require to have mental space within us. If we don't have the mental space, then we will not be able to do anything. So if we have this recipe that every day, come what may, I have to read one judgment, call out the points, make my notes, put up a small write-up. If I form this habit, I'll develop it. And then I will not ask whether the judgment is 10 pages or 20 pages or 100 pages. And we all know that judgment has several parts. It has some part where facts are noticed. It has some part where narrative of background of the case is given. It has some part where arguments are given of both the sides. It has some part where some past rulings are being culled out. And finally, the analysis, which is the operative portion. So the moment we develop this habit, we will be able to distinguish that part of the judgment which is, according to us, the ratio, and we can distinguish it from the other factors. You see, in our daily curriculum on the reading of various subjects, we come across so many judgments. When we read Contract Act, we read Lalman Shukla versus Gauri Dutta. We read Dastane versus Dastane when it comes to Hindu Marriage Act. We read Khadak Singh when it comes to constitutional law. Menaka Gandhi. But have we ever read those judgments? Have we ever analyzed those judgments? We do only the textbook reading, that in such and such case it was held like this, and reproduce it in the exam and think that our chapter is closed. Never prepare a proposition from examination point of view. We need to score marks, yes. But we need to inculcate. We need to imbibe the principle. We need to know what has been held there. If we don't do today, then when will we do it? We are going to be professionals, whether we are practicing lawyers, whether we ultimately become judges or professionals in any other field. So the duty is cast on us that we don't prepare. We are in a professional course. We are not in an ordinary course. For any course also, I would say the recipe is the same. The magnitude may be different. Quantum may be different. But basically, what we have to understand that we need to prepare ourselves so that we are able to equip this knowledge within us. I can tell you the principle embodied in Lalman Shukla versus Gauri Dutta's case is practiced in the courts of law even today. When it comes to offer, invitation to offer or acceptance. So when as a student I am being taught, why should I not read it thoroughly? For that matter, Mori Bibi versus Dharamdas Ghosh case, which we read about minor in our contract book, that is used every day in the court of law. So we must read it thoroughly. And once we have read a principle thoroughly, then the principle becomes a part of our system. Once it becomes a part of our system, we become confident. So that is how we develop a habit, we form a habit, and then we can continue. So therefore, let us not ask this question that I have limited time at my disposal. My resources are limited. We are limitless. You can imagine a young boy named Thomas Alva Edison. At the age of 21, probably it was 1868, he was born in 1847. His father had lost a job, his mother had become mentally ill. He had no resources. He started selling newspapers on the wayside trains. He set up his lab in a moving train. He won his first patent at the age of 21, in which he was probably awarded $40,000 at the relevant time. With God's grace, we have everything at our disposal. Why don't we see the worth? Why don't we see the value of everything around us? Our parents must have passed through a lot of rough patch in their lives. But they are doing everything for us. Should we not reciprocate even this much? Today, in India, we are getting about 70,000 lawyers every year. If I become part of the crowd, where would I go? In oblivion. Most of you may be saying that we don't get internship in good chambers, good law firms. Have we ever prepared ourselves, or have we ever put value on our own selves that instead of we going to firms, firms come to us? Though I am digressing from the topic of public speaking strictly, but I am talking of the related personality development issue. You see, I had a student. She was a second year student in MIT institution, about 10 years back. M.C. Mehta, one of the most famous environmental lawyers in the country, he had written an article. She wrote a critique on that, mailed it to him. She got a response, come and see me at 5 p.m. on such and such day. She went to his chambers and she described to me that her chamber was like a floor of a big office. She found big industrialists sitting there waiting for their turn, but she had an appointment. She goes and meets him. Sir, I am, her name was Zarin. Sir, I am Zarin. He says, Zarin, I am very busy today. I have called you for a reason. I'll sit with you some other day. There is a conference in Switzerland. I have nominated you. Here are the tickets. Here is the money. Here is the invite. Go and attend that conference on my behalf. Represent me. Give me a report later on. And that girl became an ongoing intern for almost 3 years with this man. He supported her so much. She narrated me a beautiful incident. She said, sir, once I went to his chambers, I saw some gentleman, a familiar face, sitting there in his chamber, having tea with him. And there was a brand new book lying at the table. She had a look at the book and Mr. M.C. Mehta said, ma'am, have you seen this book? So she looked at the book and she said, sir, I want to tell you something about this book. The person whose name is mentioned as an author has himself not written this book. It is written by one of his students, but this vice chancellor has put his name. Actually, he has not authored. And the other man was the vice chancellor, the author, who was sitting right there. And he was immediately taken aback. He said, ma'am, how did you come to know? She said, sir, I have seen your writings. You are such an intelligent man. This book has fundamental flaws. How could you commit those flaws? So I know it's one of your students who has done it. You see, this is the level of thoroughness and confidence. If we have it, anybody would like to have us. The biggest firms would like to have us as their interns. But for that, we have to make ourselves special. So another limb of public speaking is being confident, being thoughtful. I can add on to the examples. The story of a good lawyer, the story of a lawyer who does very good public speaking is that of a person who is thoroughly prepared with his brief and is well confident. As I said, this is not an overnight success. Success takes its toll. One has to spend a lot of time. The more time we spend as young students, young professionals, the better returns we will get. Not later, from now onwards. Today we know the world is of competition. I remember once there was a moot court competition going on, All India Moot Court. So I was sitting as a judge. I did not have the name of the student who was arguing in front of me, but my name was written on the table, so and so judge. And the student was arguing the case. I was countering him. Suddenly the student said, sir, I want to cite in front of you one judgment. And he took out the judgment and read it in front of me. That was the case which I argued before one of the judges and got relief in that. The alertness of that student was that he knew that judgment. he had brought it. Probably he knew earlier that I would be one of the judges there. So one has to enrich oneself in such a manner that when the situation calls, you are ready for the situation. So thoroughness and confidence, they are the two sides of a person which balance the entire scene. Without this, we are virtually non-existent. I can relate to the speech by Obama. I can relate to the speech by Mark Antony. They were great public speakers. Well, a lawyer is not a good speaker. But yes, he has to be a good presenter. My presentation about myself, my presentation about my subject, my presentation about the entire scenario in a succinct manner is the key to everything. And sometimes one line wins the argument for me. I don't have to give 100 lines. So that is the beauty of a lawyer. I must say, one issue which should not be there in our lives, and that is raising a temper. There is a tendency in the human beings that while arguing, while making submissions, sometimes we become aggressive. But sometimes we are not only aggressive, we tend to lose our temper, raise the pitch. That shrill destroys the beauty of our submission. So a good lawyer will never ever lose one's temper. We all should know, of course, as Indians it is our pride that we had such scholars. Adi Shankaracharya was an exponent of great school of thought. At that time he expounded the theory of Advaitism, that is theory of oneness with God. This was a new theory, contrary to the earlier prevalent theory of dualism, Dvaitism, that God and human beings are two different beings. So Adi Shankara was indulging in Shastra, in deliberation over his new found theory, but people were not accepting. One great scholar of the other school was named Mandan Mishra. So Adi Shankara went to have a Shastra or deliberation with him. Both of them sat. They decided that Mandan Mishra's wife, who was also a scholar of her own right, she will be the judge. That was the fairness. But the key is here. This lady, she put garland of fresh flowers around the neck of both of them. And she declared that the one whose flowers get faded first will be the loser. And then she explained. She said, the moment one raises the pitch of one's voice, gets angry or annoyed, hot air will come out of one's nostril and destroy the flowers. So anybody getting angry will destroy one's peace. And the Shastra continued probably for days together, probably 18 days if I am not wrong. And 18th day her husband lost. because he got angry. So what I am trying to tell in front of all of you, that the more composed we are, the more confident we are, more thorough we are, other traits will follow us. So public speaking for a lawyer will come to him naturally. Him includes her also, please pardon me. Provided one is thought. So I think this brings an end to my submissions. The session is open for questions.
Yes, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you for enlightening our students. And students have some questions as well I want to put forth. One question is that, sir, since you have been talking about public speaking part, I wanted to know the tip which you would like to give us, being a budding lawyer, as to how to speak in moot courts or any other conference.
Well, I think I have precisely talked about this only. But yes, one should always be honest. Suppose I don't know a point, I can very well say, I'm sorry, I do not know this. I still remember, once I was arguing a case related to labor laws. Those of us who have studied labor laws, we know there is Industrial Dispute Act, there is a Workmen Compensation Act, there is an ESI Act, there is Employees Provident Fund Act, and blah, blah, blah. Bonus Act, Minimum Wages Act, Minimum Wages Act. So I was trying to argue the principle of Industrial Disputes Act. I had taken out some judgments. I had taken out a judgment of 1958, Bombay, regarding the case which I was arguing in 1996. So the bench asked me, he says, Mr. Amar Vivek, are you aware that Parliament is in the process of amending this law altogether? There is an amendment being tabled. I said, Your Lordship, sorry, I am not aware. I tried to back myself up, but I am not aware of the amendment. I am extremely sorry. And the judges smiled at me. They said, yes, there is no such amendment, but we only wanted to know whether you are being truthful or not. So, being confident, being to the point, being precise, and being truthful. That is how we should start, and that is how we should develop. We will flourish. So I think Sayam gets his answer. It was Sayam.
It was Kushagra, sir.
Okay.
So we have one more question from Arsha Prem. Speaking in front of a panel of judges, which argument strikes better, emotional and analytical, or logical and fact-centered? Sir.
See.
Sir, I'm sorry to say, but you are not visible.
Oh, I'm not visible?
Yes, sir.
Something is happening. Sorry, maybe.
No issue, sir.
But I am audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Okay. You may answer.
Please pardon me. I've just hidden myself behind something technological glitch. See, I need not to be emotional, not to be analytical. I need not to be duplicate or artificial. I need to be original. See, yes, at times an emotional win me a case. But I should remember one thing. I should be light in the court. If I find court being very heavy, I may not win my argument. So I must make the atmosphere light. I remember once I was arguing a case passionately, and suddenly the power failure was there and the power went off. And the judge told me, smiling at me, he said, Mr. Vivek, what do we do with you? Even current has gone out of your case. So I said, my Lord, with God's grace, there is enough light. Just now the current will come and we will have light again. And that moment, the current supplies, electricity supplies were restored and everybody laughed. See, that's why I say, we should keep ourselves simple. We should keep ourselves logical. Sometimes what happens is, the moment we try to introduce external elements, if they are not required, we might lose the point. Most important is, we should not lose the point. That is the key to success.
Thank you, sir. The next question is by Vaibhav Jain. In what ways does the relationship between speaker and audience sustain you, and in what ways not?
Well, if I am not aware of my audience, if I am not aware of the nuances of my audience, be the honorable judges or the students or any forum, I am a part-time teacher also, I try to be very thorough in my lesson when I am trying to teach the students. I remember they said that I know this law, I know that law, I know this judgment. So some group of lawyers, they were trying to speak about their qualities. I know that law, I know this law. And one of them said, I know the judge. See, knowing the judge does not mean that I have some personal relations with him. Knowing the judge means knowing the atmosphere. So you have the atmosphere. You adapt yourself to that atmosphere. Connect yourself to the scenario and then make the presentation. So the more connected you are, the better result you will have. So I would say it's very important.
Thank you, sir. Then another question is from Ms. Akanksha Gandhi. Sir, how can we efficiently read lengthy judgments and at the same time retain the essence of those judgments given by Supreme Court?
See, we must read the judgments. For example, today some good judgments have come. One judgment has come on Ram Janmabhoomi issue. Other judgment has come on Sabarimala issue. They are very lengthy. Ram Janmabhoomi judgment, I think, is 248 pages or something. So, what I am telling you is, we have to form a habit, number one. Number two, we have to develop a hunger. Now, I must read this judgment. I must finish reading it. And in the process, wherever I need to back myself, I should make notes. I normally make notes of the judgments which I am reading, so that I know their important passages which I can read again. And therefore, once I develop this habit, then I will always be, you know, confident of myself. But suppose I read the judgment just for the sake of it, or I read a judgment in 10 days time, 15 days time, or just, you know, try to keep skipping my daily schedule, that will not help me. So I am sure once we develop this habit, we will have no problem.
Thank you, sir. Sir, last question is from Sayam Jain. He wants to know how to be composed while publicly speaking when people to whom you are addressing are of provoking nature.
Yeah, that will always be there. Whenever we address the courts, generally the courts are not agreeable on you. Or suppose we have an opposite counsel who wants to oppose you. So we will have these problems. But basically, one has to remember always that if you are thorough, if you are calm, or if you don't deviate from the basic protocol, I'm sure you will have no problem. But what is most important is that even in the midst of greatest provocation, your poise is something which will come in aid for you. So we should always be calm and poised. We should be facing them. We should not worry about, you know, what's happening. But yes, sometimes it puts you off. But what is expected from us is that we don't miss the point. And our point is we have to remain calm. We don't have to, maybe in the, you know, very soon the other person will realize. I can share with you, once it so happened that before a Chief Justice bench, two senior lawyers were arguing and they started being rough to each other. So the judge was observing them for quite some time and suddenly he says that Mr. Counsels may tell you something. I am not going to write this judgment immediately. I am going to reserve the judgment and after a few days only I will be writing the judgment. At that time, I will only remember your arguments and not your temper. So, we should know that judges have to give their judgment based upon our submissions or our points or our arguments. So, they are not going to know, you know, how vehement we were or how you know, aggressive we were. So, it is important that amidst aggression, we maintain the voice.
Thank you, sir. It was indeed a vibrant session. And on the behalf of Geetharthan International Business School, I would like to extend my gratitude towards you for your humble acceptance for joining us and enlightening our students with your words of wisdom. Thanks a lot, sir. And I'm thankful to students also for listening patiently. Thank you, sir.
There's a question coming in the chat box.
Yes, sir.
About some good books. And some
yes, sir. It was from.
What I can do is that you can kindly share my email ID.
Sure.
I can also try to write it down in the chat box. And you can please come back to me. I can suggest some good books to you.
Yeah. So, Akanksha Gandhi, sir, has sent email ID for you. You can talk to sir through the mail. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for joining us. Thank you, students. Thank you.
Thank you.